Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming to this post-lunch session. There are certain chips on the table. See if you can find them. It either has got two things. One, it has got TTA written on it. Or second, it has got wake up written on it.
Wake up?
Yes. Okay, did we find anything over there? No? TTA or wake up?
It's a waking up process. So is it the same thing?
Okay. And
it's from older version.
Exactly. And it doesn't matter what the chit is, but I just hope this little activity got the energy level a little bit up before we get started. But thank you for getting up. This was probably the best one. Okay. So I think enough has been said about why I did a talk yesterday also. Anyone from this room who was in my talk yesterday? Good few people, but also a few people who are not there. So first few, about 5 to 10 minutes of the talk is sort of going to be a repeat, setting the context around where we are headed toward this particular conversation. Please remember that wake up or TTA bit in that time when you're going through those aspects, okay? So today we are going to talk about to deploy or not to deploy, and one potential way of how do you get the answer using test and analyzer. That is enough about the talk, the title itself. Again, what is it that you think it means from that title? You said, okay, this is probably a tester-oriented topic. Yes and no again, okay? What are other thoughts that come to mind when you look at the title or if you have read the abstract?
I think what are the various factors that you will take into consideration while you will deploy it or not?
Okay, excellent point. What are the various criteria you would keep in mind when thinking about deployment of your build into some environment? Yes, that's one.
Failure of deployment, like something you need to probably showcasing of the various strategies, how you probably, if you fail that particular deployment, how you can probably get rid of.
So failing a particular deployment, how do we take care of that? Failure of deployment is not really something that we'll talk about, but let's see if we can cover certain aspects of that along the way.
Maybe analyzing the failed tests in order to optimize the tests that are to be run on future deployments.
Interesting. So analyzing the failure test, but the intention is to think about which ones you want to run again on future deployments or not. That might be an interesting way to optimize the process itself.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Any other thoughts?
Risk mitigation.
Risk mitigation. Interesting thing. It's a loaded concept. Risk mitigation can become very process oriented or it can be very practical. The practical aspects you can probably get out of this talk. There's nothing theoretical about this in the talk itself. Okay, so let's see how we can cover some of these particular topics. Before we get to actual core testing concept, right, and this is where the slight repetition is going to happen, and I'm going to move through a little bit quickly unless there are questions from this, because it doesn't make sense repeating the same thing again. So why are organizations there? They want to provide some value. And to provide value, they have to get the product out on time. To get the product out on time, just getting the product out on time is not sufficient. You want to also have it of good quality. And these things are going hand in hand. The other reality, which is true, is that the global spread and distribution of organizations for various reasons, globalization or the cost factor, team sizes, mergers, acquisition, talent, you want to reach out to the talent pool available across the globe. And how can we do that? One way is to spread our wings and go in different places. So these are the organization objectives, the reasons why they are spread. Now, when it comes to this era of sorts, or it's been around for quite some time, we've been in that phase, fashion, we want to get to the market quickly, and we have to apply a lot of principles, practices to really get there. One of the practices that we are going to talk about is about automation and how it can make teams successful. Now this is, again, like risk mitigation, this is probably a much more loaded question. What does it mean by test automation? And what factors make it the team successful? Or how can it make teams unsuccessful also. Bottom line, it's very clear. Automation is code. If you don't treat it with the same respect as product code, it is going to lead eventually into teams being unsuccessful with that particular practice. So you really have to understand the core nitty-gritties of what that coding aspect of it is, the design patterns required for it, choosing the right tool set which is applicable for your product, and various other factors, and have the right discipline on the team to say how are we really going to automate or not for this particular product that we are looking at. If that is not done well, then of course that practice becomes a hindrance more than helping teams take good decisions going forward from that. Okay? So what is test automation? It is a safety net. Again, we spoke a lot about this yesterday. A net, like a fisherman goes to catch fish using a fishing net, he would not go with a net of a very wide grid size to catch a small fish. The fish is just going to escape. At the same time, if he wants to catch a big fish and if he goes with a net of very small size, he might not catch the big fish, yes, but he will also end up catching a lot of other things which he is not really concerned about or doesn't really want in that sense. So it's very important to understand this about automation. What are the tests to be automated? How to automate that to get the right kind of feedback for the team? Okay? A concept which really helps build on doing good automation is a test pyramid. A concept introduced by Mike Kuhn in his book, Succeeding with Agile, a long time ago. Martin Fowler has written about it, one of the inkers of the Agile Manifesto. He's written a lot about this. And what this pyramid says is, it is a pyramid, of course, right? The pyramid has got various different types of tests. These types of tests are dependent on what is applicable for your product. So you would find out all the opportunities where you can add different types of tests, and that would comprise your pyramid. How do you order this? This is very easy in that sense. The maximum number of unit tests should be there because of pyramid, the base has to be wider. And as you keep going up the pyramid, the number of tests should reduce. Why? These, up to the view tests, in this particular example, all these types of tests are more technology-facing side of this. If you are validating if a checkbox has to be changed to a radio button for whatever reason, actually writing tests to ensure no other flows are breaking or the functionality is actually working from a technical perspective. But why is that change really required? Why did we want to change it from a radio button to a checkbox or whatever control or changing the flow, the feature? That is a business impact of it. And your web service tests, UI tests, the exploratory tests, that has to focus on that particular aspect, the business impact of why are we trying to do that. The other thing that happens because of the pyramid is the cost as you keeps on going up as you go from bottom to top of the pyramid. The cost in terms of implementation, the cost in terms of where are you going to run the test. Unit test can run on a developer machine itself, but to get a Vue test done or a JavaScript test or a UI test for that matter, you might need to get the complete build done and deployed in some environment for you to be able to run that type of test. So the cost required to build, implement these tests has gone up. And also now you need more infrastructure, build and deployments to be done correctly in order to run the business side of this. So that is an important thing to consider. Also what that means is the time taken to execute each test keeps going up. Now this time is also a two-factor time, right? One is the actual time to run the test itself. A unit test, thousands of tests can potentially run in minutes if it is well distributed, parallelized, all those other practices. But a UI test, a single UI test, if you have to just do a login to Gmail, it is going to take time to open the browser, go to that page, find the controls, enter data, and then say, okay, have I logged in or not? It takes a lot of time to execute the test as well. So that is one factor about the time aspect of these tests. As you keep going up the pyramid, the time required to execute each test and get feedback has gone up. The second factor is the feedback aspect of it. The unit test is running on a developer machine before the code has been committed to version control system. Versus for a UI test, you now not only potentially need to get all other code, which means you have to get more code pulled in or compiled or check into some particular repository, build, deploy, and then you start seeing that feedback. So it's not just the time taken to execute a test, also when can you really execute the test? That is also gone. The part that the pyramid doesn't really talk about very well in all that literature that I've found online is the concept of the impact of each test on the product. It is not very explicit, it is very implicit. What this means is the unit test, which is at the base of the pyramid, is actually impacting granular pieces of your code, of your product code. It might be a class, a set of classes, a component, whatever it might be. As you keep going up, now you need more and more of that code pulled together, assembled, built, deployed in whichever fashion to run those tests. So the clear impact is from unit test perspective is granular pieces of change in the code. Versus for a UI, the impact is on the breadth of the product. It's about can I log in and send an email? That is the breadth of the product. It is not just about a checkbox to radio button over there, right? So what that means is the impact has to be like that. Unfortunately, in most cases, we forget about all these concepts when it comes to implementation. When it comes to implementation, either we just know about unit tests or almost every time the focus on test automation means it is functional UI automation. Let's build that layer. Invest in tools, people, whatever we need to make that happen. But we don't really consider the kind of impact it has for each test that is required in order to get the quick feedback for the team. Okay? So this is an extremely important concept in order to get the feedback loop correct for your particular product. There are various anti-patterns. Some of we spoke about those anti-patterns yesterday. I'm not going to go through that today because the focus is really different. Okay? So now if this is the pyramid, how does your test automation pyramid really look like? Each one of you should introspect for the teams you are working with, the products you are impacting of, as part of your team. What kind of automation effort do you really have? Are you really getting that kind of quick feedback from your test automation suite? And if not, how can you make that better? But anyway, that's not the topic right now. This concept is very important as we get to the next thing about continuous integration. Because remember, it's all about feedback. Why do we do automation? To get quick feedback if the product still has the right quality or has something broken along the way. Might be intended, not intended, but how can we find that as quickly as possible? And CI is one classic way of doing that, where as soon as a developer checks in a code, puts in code into the version control system, automatically tests should run on some central machine where all code has come together up to that point in time, and tests are going to run. Which tests? Again, it's all the tests that are listed in the test pyramid. All those different types of tests. Of course, you would need to sequentialize them because you want to get quick feedback. And if obvious things are going wrong, you don't want to spend a lot of time waiting for that feedback. So there'll be some form of staggering. The other important thing to consider is even before it gets to CI, we need to provide ways to the team, which means, again, good practices, tools, processes in place to get, to allow the developers to run those tests on their machine, whichever is applicable, of course, to the changes they are making, so that they get the feedback even before it gets into version control system. So version control is still the next thing. CI is still the next thing beyond the developer scope of influence, what tests can be run. Okay? So if this is CI, the definition, how does it really look? As we spoke, our developer is doing some changes on his machine. That code gets into version control system, and tests automatically run. What is the frequency of these test runs? It should, the test should be triggered on every new check-in that comes in. Of course, if it's a large team, for example, if everyone is working on that same code base, there would be hundreds of check-ins if we are following good practice per day. Because we are doing atomic small check-ins, right? That means hundreds of times a test would run. Well, not really. Because if we have triggered the test, maybe the tests are taking a few minutes. In that time, maybe 3-4 people have committed the changes. The next test will aggregate all those commits and run tests based on that. So it's not per commit necessarily. It's every opportunity where the source code has changed, take the latest code and run the tests over there.
Just a question. So what would be this? So I understand that it's also linked to the gated check-in. Gated check-in, as you said.
What do you mean by
that? So when I check in and then it goes to the CI server, if my check-ins have some anomalies with the test automation script that is running, you could probably throw me out or say that you are not successful. Is it something?
So there are various approaches to really having a good practice on the team, especially from automation perspective. And this is something teams who have good practices in place do that. They lock down the branch or the repository if any test has failed. No new developer or no developer will be able to check in more code if any tests have failed. And in that case, what happens? There are a lot of tools which give that kind of information, the radiators and automatic notification, in the sense that since the last time I ran the test, there were so many check-ins. There were 10 check-ins that happened, maybe from the same developer or 10 different developers. One of those check-ins has caused the test to break. So notification will go to all of them. It is their responsibility to fix the issue immediately or roll back the changes, make sure the build goes green again, and automatically the branch is unlocked.
Yeah?
So
when I devise this testing approach, if I go back to your pyramid which you just showed, for check-in, which the layer of the pyramid I was choosing from, or which like?
It's all tests. And all tests, right? So if the team is really aggressive about their practices for a good reason, right? That no test should be failing. And no test could also include NFRs for that matter, right?
Mm.
Whatever performance security test that you have automated, even that might be a part of your process to say if any of these tests have failed, I want to make sure I just stop the process over there, fix the issue, make sure it's not going to happen again, and then open it up again. That's ideal.
Yeah, so but many times we see that when we run the whole test suite, then we get the compiled report of the test that actually failed.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm trying to say that instead of having that compiled report in the end, as soon as a test fails, it should be stopped there. A step fails, it should be stopped there, and then a developer should be informed. Because at times, it may not be a defect. It may be...
Absolutely. So the question is, if the first test failed, do you want to stop over there, or you want to wait for the suite to get over before you get the reports?
Yeah.
You definitely want the suite to get it,
right?
Because it might not just be one issue which has been caused by whatever change. There might be many issues. And in such cases, if it's completely random issues, we just want to roll back those changes as a first step, get it to a clean state again, so the build is going on in a proper fashion. You already have a compiled list of whatever has failed anyway. And you could use that to say, okay, now what do I need to do to fix these? Because for all you know, those tests might be outdated.
Yeah.
Right? You need to fix those first. What has happened? The developer has not taken the extra step or is unable to take that extra step to run those tests first before the check-in was done. So you've used the CI server to sort of give you that feedback instead of you doing it on your own machine. Right? So there are a lot of practices around this, what can be done. There are a lot of constraints. Most of those constraints might be artificial constraints. There are a lot of valid constraints. You have to work around that, related to domain, product, team distribution, various things around that. Okay? But we've seen a lot of cases where even in distributed teams, if the build has gone red, the first thing you come in the morning, see a red build, roll back the changes. Because the team is on the other side of the world. You cannot really get that kind of feedback or understanding immediately. They're sleeping that time. So just roll back those changes, let them know this is what happened, I've rolled it back, the build is green again, look at those results again and commit again when you come in the morning. So there are various practices that can happen.
Or sometimes we ignore those tests also.
And it's as good as saying I always want a green build. The failing tests provide good inputs, but those inputs are only valid if you're actually looking at them.
Yeah.
Otherwise it's as good as saying that automation is useless, whatever it might be, it doesn't make sense to proceed. It doesn't make sense to automate for that matter, I would say it that way. A lot of teams actually say, I know we are digressing a little, but it's a good conversation. A lot of teams say that, oh, this test is failing, it's a complex fix. Let's just skip this test for now. That is the worst thing that you can do, because a failing test tells you that there's something wrong in the product, you need to fix it. The minute it has gone off the radar, management is going to say, yeah, the build is fine, why do you need to prioritize that?
There's no point doing
that. Exactly. A red build is more important than a green build because it tells you there's something wrong.
And that's the purpose of your...
Exactly. So you need to keep, you need to have that rigor. Every person should be saying that, let's stop what we are doing. Who's looking at this build right now? Who's fixing these issues? Or who's rolling it back to get it in the same state? Someone always has to wear that hat to say, let's take a step back. Okay? So that is what CI is, right? As the code keeps coming in, you keep on getting the latest changes, run tests against that, when you commit changes to version control, the same thing will continue again. And that way, you're ensuring for a chunk of check-ins that is happening together, because multiple people are involved at the same, doing changes at the same time, how are we really getting feedback for at least those changes as quickly as possible? Okay? So in terms of seeing the results now, the tests have run. How do you really see the results? So you would go to your CI server. There's some dashboard on CI Jenkins or Team CT, Hudson, whichever you have. You're running tests from that. It is polling for changes in the repository. It can be triggered manually. So you go to the CI server, look at the dashboard, see what has failed, and take some actions out of it. And this sort of looks like this, right? Where you can see, oh, this was my history of jobs. This is whatever plugins you are using to get the information out of it. And okay, yeah, everything seems to be fine, or we need to take further steps around that. This is what everyone does, right? This works if you have small teams. If this table is working independently, that table is working independently on different products completely, they're not really related to each other. But the minute this whole room, all the teams over here for whatever function areas they're working on, is working towards the same end goal, it starts getting complex. How do you start seeing that aggregated report for a complex team structure, which might be distributed as well? How do you get that common dashboard really created to tell you, fine, my CI told me about what tests I'm running, but how is it all coming together? Because my test might be fine, but because of my changes, some other team's functionality has started breaking. You would never know about that. So that unified dashboard becomes very, very necessary as the team structure goes complex. And that is something which is really a limitation of the current set of tools and processes that we are working. So what would typically happen in this case? Let's say the three tracks, there are three different geographies where teams are located, different time zones. So potentially what might happen is, oh, this room and the next room, they're close proximity. So these two set of teams working on that cross individual products towards that enterprise product suite that you have, they would potentially share a CI server because they're sort of related. It's easier to combine those, have it on the same infrastructure. Again, another advantage is that you don't want to just have so many CI servers as well, right? So you would want to spread that out. The other case would be, oh, those two other teams in different geographies, which are doing some related work, they would share some other CI server. And which is, again, a very practical thing to do, in my opinion, because you cannot have everything in one place just for the sake of having it in one place. So you have to sort of spread it out to make it more manageable, maintainable as well. But if such a thing happens, when your CEO, CIO, or some product manager comes across and says, okay, it's great, everyone is working well, how does it all come together? Can someone, oh, you are a test manager or some product manager for your team, and you are a product manager for some other team, I want a unified dashboard, a unified view about the state of quality of where my product suite is right now. So what happens is, there's a lot of manual work that needs to happen in a repeated fashion. Maybe it's once per week, once per quarter, once per fortnight, whatever that frequency might be. It is always manual. You have to start aggregating reports, put it into some template or PowerPoint to say, this is what it sort of looks like at a high level. This is a very manual process. Can anyone relate with me?
Yeah.
Is there any solution that you have come across that will help solve this? It's always manual?
Super.
No, so if I want to say the general health of the product, we are talking about backlog. What is the state of quality of my product right now?
Quality.
Okay, so all the test results, the defects that were found, whatever the dashboard might look like. This is what we are planning for future work, whatever, right? But more importantly, what is the state of quality right now? CI will tell you one thing from a test automation perspective. There might still be a lot of manual regression or exploratory testing that you're doing, which are tracking in some fashion. How do you get those consolidated? How do you get things consolidated from all these three different teams or four different teams together, because they are all related to the same thing? the same end goal.
But if anything will encounter an effect, they will put it in the backlog.
No, so we are not talking about managing backlog. We are talking about how do we know what is the quality of our product at this point in time. CI, the results from CI is going to tell us how many have passed, how many have failed. That's real time.
Right.
Right? But now I want to aggregate the information across all the teams, not just one team. And that is a manual task. Because you might have, as I said over here, you might have different CI servers, for example.
So overall, what kind of quality we are maintaining, you wanted?
Exactly. The overall picture is what we are looking. This one is telling me about these two products. This one is telling about these two products. How does it come together? Because they are still related with the same organization. I want to know my overall quality of the products that I'm working on. How do we do that? And that part has to be done manually. I want to take, this is a CI dashboard image. It could be any dashboard that you have, right? I want to take this and combine them together to give it off as a report to someone. Why it is important? They want to know the future direction, where the next investment should happen from quality perspective, or it's overemphasis on certain things, we need to scale back for whatever reason. Where do we reprioritize? Various decisions, managers, leaders, business people would want to take based on that. So that is a challenge. In smaller teams, it is fine. CI and whatever dashboard will work out fine. Larger teams, distributed teams, that's where the complexity comes. The other aspect that comes across is that in CI, typically, who works on CI environments over here or uses CI very regularly? In CI, how many days do you typically store the results? How many builds or how many days?
Just five, last five.
Last 5 minutes, for example. Okay. What is the project life cycle or your product life cycle?
It's quite big, but we just save last five because we don't want too much data on there.
Exactly. Right. There is a limitation of how much, not limitation of space, there's limitation of how much value that data will add from a CI perspective. So you would typically have a 30-day, last 30 days, or last 10 builds, last 5 builds, whatever is right for the team. That's what you would say, as long as the build is green, I'm okay. But then, for enterprise products, which lifecycle is not the development lifecycle, the product lifecycle, right? You're going through years and years and multiple revisions of those type of products. How do you capture trends? How the quality has been, or how the product has been doing? Is CI going to give you that information? On what basis are you going to do that? Again, we get to some form of manual massaging of that data from historical records, usually from emails, and try to create that kind of data. And that is a problem from a large product cycle context. How do we manage that? Okay? Now the next bit is, fine, you have CI. You have your tests automated. Does a green build mean there are no defects? So there was a slight digression again. There was a big discussion, is TDD dead? Between Martin Fowler, DHH, and Kent Beck. Kent Beck made a very interesting comment. He said, we should have red pixels all over the green build. Why? It will give the team indication that there might still be something you have not found. Very interesting concept. But the point here now is that how do you know that if your product is ready to go to the next level? It might be from a QA to a UAT or pre-prod or any other environment, or actually to production. How do you know? How do you know if a green build or all passing tests really mean there is no defects? And that is where this concept of test trend analyzer comes in. I had this in mind for a long time. Eventually, after a couple of years, I got a chance to work on it. And the whole intention of this is to come across, solve some of these problems from a management perspective about knowing, understanding trends, making more intelligent business decisions, where do you want to invest in terms of quality? Understanding that quality from an end product perspective. And also for developers or the team members, developers, QAs, whoever's working on the teams, what is the quality of my product? How can I make better analysis of those results and take meaningful decisions? Where do I need to prioritize fixing which defect or not? Okay? So I'm going to give you a quick demo instead of showing more slides around that. But we are going to look at specific aspects of this, not all of these, in interest of time. And let's go through that aspect. So I will now sit over here. Okay, we are able to see. This UI is really can't even say web 1.0, I would call it. It's really poor. It was built as an open source pet project of sorts. So look at the concept, not really the look and feel out of it. A disclaimer from my side. Okay, so from a trend analysis perspective, we are investing a lot in our automation. How do we know, are we, what type of pyramid we are really having in our team or our product? Am I actual pyramid? Am I ice cream cone? Or what type of pyramid do I have? I'm investing so much in all types of automation. And this is one view which will take the latest set of tests for that particular sub-project that we have worked on. And it will tell me what are the different types of tests, how many tests are there, total time, and some general representation of saying what is my investment of testing. Am I investing too much on UI automation versus unit, or what is it really happening? And over here, it's really clear, right? The time taken to execute these 113 functional tests is around 10 minutes versus to execute 140. Oh, this test data is, the test data is wrong over here. I seeded this data. But this will tell you what type of, how much time it really took to execute what type of test. That becomes very, very powerful. But, this is from the latest test execution that has happened for different types of tests. It is using that kind of information to create this.
As of now, the test type and passing has been shown is the way it is now, or it has been then when we have not taken any action towards it?
This is the current state.
Okay.
This is the current state.
Okay.
So this gives you a lot of insights into saying that, okay, I have started investing more in unit tests. It is getting close to number of functional tests. But let's say in 3 months' time, I want to really double the ratio between unit and functional. For whatever reason, that number has come to my mind. The team knows what is the right mix, of course. But this gives you some insight into where you are, where are you investing in automation, and is there a scope to make it better to get the feedback quick. Okay? That becomes one thing from a pyramid perspective. And since the data is there, you can easily extend this view to say that, okay, this was a pyramid 3 months ago, this is a pyramid now. Am I really making progress in the right direction? You can start comparing. That is the first thing from a trend analysis view. The other thing which becomes really powerful.
One question.
Yeah?
So is the number of tests, because the number of tests at a unit test level and the one test at unit test level and one test at functional test level, I don't know if they are same.
They're not at all the same. They're not at all the same. So as I said, this is seed data that I've created in a script aspect, right? But if this is what the number of tests were, we understand the pyramid well, the idea about feedback well. That is an alarm bell in my mind to say, in our minds, to say, why are we doing so much functional? Why are we not investing more on unit tests? Because that will give us faster feedback. So it's a visual data representation of what is happening in the build right now. Okay, it gives you an insight to say, where do you need to focus on to make it better? Or maybe for some reason, the unit test might remain at that level. We have to add functional because the product is like that. The pyramid is a concept. The test pyramid is a concept. The actual size or shape of the pyramid, only the team can define what it means. Should it actually be an ice cream cone or cylinder or what form it might be?
I was just wondering whether you think something like a code coverage or a branch coverage or a path coverage might actually be yet another way to corroborate that data. Where, for example, you are looking at only the code coverage in a unit test level, but at an integration or a functional level, you are looking at the path coverage or branch coverage and some of these things. So you are able to...
Absolutely. And these are various different metrics that will together give you the representation, right? It's not just one thing.
So whole development metrics is together.
Exactly,
together.
Exactly. It all has to come in together. The challenge with using coverage from a functional perspective, you're running it as a black box. So it is, you have to invest a lot in the tooling aspect and lock down that environment to get more information
at
on that.
At a functional level, we don't want to look at a code coverage.
Exactly.
But we want to look at more at a path coverage.
Yeah, absolutely. So you could, you'll have to correlate all this different data to say, where am I? Is that the right state? Or if this is the state, what will be the next better state? How can I target moving towards that one? Gives you just a visual representation instead of number-based representation.
And also maybe the energy curve, how much energy I'm spending, maybe in terms of total number of points I'm spending to execute these number of test cases. these kind of estimates, the how much ROI I am making out of them.
Correct.
These kind of investment figures would help.
So ROI is actually something that is a very big debate in my mind, because it is perceived very differently in various different ways, right? But in a nutshell, I think yes, I agree. At a conceptual level, you have to look at not just the test execution output, but more details around that code base. And it's not just code base, about you can think about velocity and various other factors to see, are you working in an optimal way or is there scope for improvement? Okay. So the other view that is important is a comparative analysis view. Over here, I've selected a date range, and for that date range, I've selected some particular sub-project and what different types of tests execute for that sub-project. I could have selected all the sub-projects in that project, right? Whatever that structure might be. This view is going to tell you, for that time period, what are the different types of tests that have run, what has their passing percentage been in a trend fashion for each different type of suite that is there. And why is this important? It tells me this team, whichever team this is representing, the lower one, this team is doing a really crappy job in terms of getting results from their automation. Now, it might be that the capability is not right, the skills is not right, or that functionality is really very complex and changing so often that the tests are not in sync. But it tells me, as a manager of sorts, or someone who's overlooking things, I need to invest more over here than any other place. I need to focus direction more over here than in this case of maybe the yellow one, where this might have been a discrepancy of getting some tests failed. But in general, it is at a high passing rate, or maybe 100% passing rate. Maybe that team has well set up in processes, practices, whatever those parameters are. But that is OK. I don't need to put as much time figuring out how to solve that problem. Let me focus over here instead. Okay, that becomes another very big holistic view over a time period. It's not just the latest builds for each different type, yes, the builds are passing or not. Holistically, you're looking at it to say, where do I need to invest more or not? That becomes another powerful thing.
So this one you're saying is categorized, if I understand it rightly, it's categorized on the team basis.
Yes, so the concept that we'll talk about in a little bit, if we get time, when we look at the metadata, right, what type you capture. Right now, the structure is project, sub-project, and then different types of tests.
Okay.
But this can be extended in various ways to say, okay, what your team structure really is in terms of teams or products, whatever, and you could classify based on that. I just chose one project, and I chose one sub-project, but it had so many different types of tests, so that's why it showed it up like this.
So,
okay.
So, just a question about it. So you are also addressing some of this dashboard. Let's say, same similar stuff, right? I probably can try to look for a trend and a certain period of time, and I probably have in mind a threshold.
Absolutely.
A particular thing.
Absolutely.
And then LCN, UCL stuff,
yep.
You can get into it.
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, that
so the data is available for you to use in whichever fashion.
Yeah. If I do a 6 month analysis and I
exactly.
Ask the manager what is my LCN, UCL, I can
yeah.
Really figure it out.
You could do that.
Yeah.
Okay. So the other quick thing I want to talk about is test execution trends. Now, this is especially important, I believe, from a functional testing perspective. And I'll just quickly show you the data for it. Suggestions. Okay, this one, functional. Again, I select a time range. And why is this important, the test execution trends? For example, if I have some business use case that is automated, and that use case is pretty stable in that sense, right? Login, create an email, send an email, verify it has been sent. That's a use case. Over a period of time, as I'm keeping on adding more and more functionality, how has this really been performing in terms of time taken to execute? So we are just looking at the test, the time it takes to execute that test whenever it has run, and plot that graph to say, okay, these seem to be an anomaly, so I'm going to take the 95 percentile or ignore the bottom 5 percentile. If this is my general trend, I need to find out what is really happening when it is spiking. Maybe something happened in the build at that point in time, which might have resulted in a business case taking more time to execute.
This is basically from a test suite
specific
perspective.
Test
suite perspective.
Not test suite, a specific test.
One test case.
Sending an email.
Okay.
Verify email, you can send an email. That is a use case. That is a functional test that is automated. It can be for unit tests also.
But it's an end-to-end scenario, right?
as I said, it can be any test. It can be a unit test or a functional. So I'll go back to this one. Test execution. So if I select any data over here, it can be integration unit function. That's the data that I have for this particular subproject. I can select anyone. If I select a unit test for a particular range, there might be thousands of unit tests. For any specific unit test, if you want to see how is that trend really been, you can see it. It might give you some insights into it.
In all those cases where we have seen spike, would it be reported as green or red? It can be either.
This is not making any judgments, it's just giving you a visual representation.
So I'm asking you, at some point of time, for two cases. One, you have mentioned that email case, where it still might go, because I'm probably taking more time to integrate into the email server. But then the other case where probably I'm interacting with a third party or I'm moving to a service, it might time out and then I still spend that amount of time and then it's time and it might fail. But it would show just the time, right?
That view is based on the time. Okay. So now I just want to show one quick thing before we get to the next thing. I need 5 more minutes to wrap it up. This part becomes very important about failure analysis. This is, remember, failure analysis, not defect analysis. What this means is if my test suite has got hundreds or thousands of tests for whatever reason, they might be running as part of different jobs or anything. If out of 1,000 tests, 10% tests are failing, you need to fix them for sure. Which one do you start fixing first? So if your test framework has been built in the correct fashion with the correct error reporting, this view is going to tell us which test has started failing for the same reason. So based on the error messages that you're logging, it is now saying this is not sorted right now, but this particular error message for class 3 dot whatever, there are 25% tests failed for that exact reason. So if I pick up this issue to resolve first, 25% of my failing tests are going to start passing.
That requires to build the framework in such a way.
Exactly. In this case, it is just about having proper logging.
Error handling, yeah.
Exactly. It's just about proper logging, right? And that's it's a tough problem to solve, but if you get that right, you get the bang for the buck to say which one do I need to fix first. It makes a big difference. Okay? So getting back, there are many other features and we've not had time. Yeah?
Just one question. How do you integrate this to the existing?
Yeah, that's where we are getting into. Okay? So, how does this really work? There are two ways. One is a manual upload, and second is an automatic upload. Manual upload is something you would say, I want to try it out to see if it is going to work for me based on the results that I'm generating. Let me try it out if TTA can support whatever happens, log formats and everything. So manual upload is a simple form with a lot of data. You would upload all that information there, submit, and you will immediately see the results in whichever view you want. That's one way. Second is the automatic upload, and this is where I think the real power of TTA comes through. We know how CI works. There are jobs which run tests on specific agents. What that really means is, I'm going to move on this side, that when the test is executing on the agent, you're doing some clean, compile, setup of the test, then run the test, and then the results come back to CI. That's what typically happens. So in TTA, that part remains the same. The only difference is before results go to CI server, you're sending it to TTA, and then it's going to CI. So results are going in two places now. Okay? That's the difference. Why is this very powerful? Because now my CI can be anything, Go, Bamboo, Team City, any CI. My test can be test runners or build tools can be anything, Ant, Maven, Gradle, Makeray, Groovy, whatever you are using over there. My test can be implemented in any language using any framework. All I'm doing is I have to update this portion to say, after I'm done running the test, send results to TTA, please, and that's it. So you're only making change to the build tool side of it. The developers don't know, they can of course know, but they're not affected by this change. No one who's writing automation is affected by this change. So this becomes really powerful, right? Because now I don't have to change anything. I'm just setting up TTA in one place, changing my build process, my build tool rather, to send results over there in the format that is required, and that's it. I'm done. Now you can start looking at TTA to see all those results. Exactly. It's everything agnostic. Only you need to figure out, there are samples in GitHub about how to use Ant or Maven or those kind of things. But any new thing that comes up, that's the only additional bit that you need to do. Which if there's a good person who understands the build tool well, it's a matter of few minutes.
I'm only using it in the job for that, right?
No, so this is, this concept ThoughtWorks gave me the opportunity to work in my free time and whoever was able to contribute. So ThoughtWorks has got a big role in this. But this is an open source project which is available on GitHub. You could just go to GitHub, download it, set it up in your own environment, and you're good to go. Okay? This is a manual upload form where you can see a lot of data. So when you do download it, first thing you want to do is get the relevant type of data, upload it, see if it is working. Because what happens is the test logs that you are getting, N unit, J unit logs, regardless of type of test, that has to be parsable by TTA. If it's a format that is not supported, then you need to update TTA to support that. It's a plugin based architecture. Okay? So this is what TTA is. We did not speak about some other concepts, but how can you help? There are a lot of features that I have in mind what needs to happen. First thing is making it a better user experience for sure. It looks really crappy in my opinion. But that is one thing. But there are a lot of other features which can be added which gives value. So that is one thing. Use it. Give feedback. That will be very helpful. Even if you're not able to contribute to it, you can give ideas what would work or what are the limitations you see in the tool or what you are using in your organization, and it can be something that potentially can be looked at. Okay? The last thing that I'm going to show over here in the demo itself, this is not a replacement for any dashboard. There is a lot of value from CI, Jira, or whichever other tools we're using. It gives a lot of information from day-to-day perspective. This is not to replace anything. This is giving a historic data for trending and analysis perspective. However, it would be nice to have a one place to go for all these other tools and dashboards, right? And that's why there's a concept of an external dashboard that we have built in, where in this case, I've just linked my blog to it, but I could link any page, any dashboard I want in my organization, whether it's a CI dashboard or a Jira or a Mingle or whatever other dashboards, I could link it over here. So this becomes a one place to go, but get information from the right tools wherever required. You're not duplicating anything at any point in time. Okay? So with that, I'm actually going to stop. That's all I really had to share. Don't know if you have time for questions or not. Okay, so we can talk more.
One of the feedback I have, because you were asking for that, one of the things we generally use is, we have a similar thing. We have just an Excel embedding all this data and macros highlighting the weak areas.
Hmm.
So the focus areas with the mixture of all, like if the code coverage, like you're saying, code coverage, line coverage, branch coverage, code churn. So all these things which make sense, which are the weak areas we can identify from the complete report.
Yeah.
That can be one area where we can...
It's true, but there are already tools which excel in that specific area, right? So for code analysis or static analysis or code coverage type of things.
A complete picture of all these together and highlighting the weak areas.
That is an interesting thing.
Yeah.
Like a mapping of like if the code coverage is if the the code churn is high in this particular module itself, and the test case coverage is less in this, then this is probably one of the weak areas.
Yeah. So I think it's an excellent point. It's a great opportunity to look into. So far, what I've done is to keep it as agnostic as possible, because I don't want to build plugin for Jira or Jenkins or the different versions of that. That said, though. Maybe it's the output format that these tools generate that can be consumed to do something about it instead of specific plugin to the tool. But
we have put it in an Excel only, not using any plugins.
Correct.
Putting all the data, putting macros in there.
So the thing that I'm trying to solve here is not to use any manual intervention.
Right. And
so this is going to
that
be
is
more,
integrated. Yeah.
But fair point. I think it's something definitely to look at as opportunities. What other features that can be there?
Thank you.
Yeah, so it's a matter of how the tests have been. So I'm going to interrupt that question, right? Because I think others have started coming through. So if it's not running as part of CI, also it's fine.
Yeah.
How are you triggering the test?
I'm going to do a trend analysis that is given, right? Probably I want to do a 6 month analysis and see what kind of defect that's been thrown and then probably work with it.
Yeah.
Currently, that modification doesn't happen.
Yeah, so it can be fine. So there are challenges with some tools, for example, which cannot be put on CI easily. Likewise, on developer machines, if you want to run some tests, you want to track that also potentially, right? So the build tool can take care of that aspect also. It doesn't have to be triggered from CI. The difference is before you send the results somewhere, that's where you need to say, okay, I want to, before I create my report, I want to send the results to TTA, for example. If that's where you need to make the changes. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.